And it is not necessarily a judicial or quasi-judicial forum in which the right is claimed. The right is claimed from executive bodies as well, where the service is being delivered.
I think she's also trying to find out if possibly through the community work that's going on in UP, whether these issues percolate down to the work that you directly do with the women at the village level.
As I said earlier, our work with communities is in Uttaranchal. The Sahyog community development work is in Uttaranchal.
Right.
And there it's not so much health, that there is indigenous knowledge and empowerment. So there the model is slightly different. We work with only Dalits and we work with indigenous knowledge.
Right.
Oh, that started with the process of participatory rural appraisal. Community analysis of their own strengths and resources. And yeah. There is an entire team which works in about 30 villages. But this work is, that is not so rights focused. In the sense of this kind of rights focused work. You see, I can tell you that it is your right to marry the person of your choice. I can tell you that. And you might know it, but you might not even know it. So just informing somebody about rights, while being important, is not sufficient for the person to make that claim.
On the other hand, informing not individuals but entire communities of the existence of such rights creates the climate in which it is easier for individuals to claim those rights.
Absolutely.
Right? Like in page season Karnataka, for example, one of the things that we're trying to do now is to make a reasonably comprehensive list of what rights patients can expect from those health centers and have each of those centers provide public postings of them at the center, at local panchayat offices near those kind of centers. And people always said, many people know that they have a right to these things. But even at that, we find that posting that right in a language comprehensible to the population creates the climate in which people say, I know I have the right. I know that you know that I have that right. And that dynamic becomes important for some systems.
Changing, let's say, behavior within communities is far easier because you have an enabling environment rather than doing it alone. Where was that?
How much of an abortion is post-abortion and during abortion?
Okay.
Sex
selective. In UP.
Yeah.
Tricky, because no study has been done. And there is sex selective abortion, but it's not as clear, the data is not as clear as, let us say, Punjab, Haryana, Gujarat, Uttaranchal, Himachal.
Even in Uttaranchal,
yeah. Sex? I've been talking about it for a long time.
I would like to hear more about that. Thank you.
You see, the suspicion of this fact, I'm sure you people are aware of it, that the suspicion, sex selective abortion, in Uttaranchal I have been talking about, in Himachal, I don't know whether you know Subhash Mendapurkar, we've been talking about, and that's why we are not, neither Subhash is popular in Himachal and Uttaranchal through me. Because both these places, you have very good educational indicators for these women, it has very good indicators in terms of overall sex ratio. It has very good indicators in terms of age at marriage. But these gross indicators, our work with communities that made us feel, did not reflect the lower status of women, even embedded within a so-called, slightly better aggregate statistics. What happened after the 2001 decennial census was, for the first, it had been done earlier on the 0 to 4 age group. For the first time, 0 to 6 age group sex, what should I say, ratios were computed separately. And across the board in India, in the last 10 years, since 1991 to 2001, there has been remarkable drop in sex ratio of 0 to 6 children. Now, adult sex ratios in places like Uttaranchal is positive, like Kerala. Not because there are more women and the status of women is higher, because there is higher out-migration. If you see Eastern Europe, if you know Eastern Europe in your future, Eastern UP in your view, states like Gorakhpur, Azamgarh are very poor, very patriarchal, but with very good sex ratios, because all the men are out. Similarly, Uttaranchal districts like Almora, Tihri, Pauri had very high sex ratio, 1080, whereas UP was 890 or something. Primarily because men were out. But when you look at child sex ratio, you can safely assume that before the age of 6, people are not migrating for work at least. If the family goes, the entire unit goes. Doesn't leave one child here and one child there. And that perhaps is a better index of number of boys and girls. Theoretically, a little more boys are born. But boys are biologically weaker. So they die off quicker and it levels off to the same. And overall population-based sex ratio, women are more than men in most developed countries. I don't want to get into that too much. But what we found in the sex ratio of 0 to 6 is that there are great differences. And when they did it for the last 10 years, they found in 4 states, the drop had been more than 50 per thousand. So 5% drop. Gujarat, very educated, very economically well off. Punjab, economically well off, not so educated. And Himachal, educated and not perhaps so well off. Haryana.
It dropped really badly.
It was not the 50 plus group.
Yeah, okay.
In all states except Kerala, it dropped. Uttaranchal didn't make the 50 cut because it was 48. So this alerted people to the fact that there is a large sex selective abortion. There's been a study in Haryana, I think Haryana, yeah, and some Punjab, some districts there, where they did this NTP statistics. And they found that even the total fertility rate, or the number of children that has been reduced, is primarily to abortions, not because of practice of contraception. So Ashish Bose theorizes that in places like UP and Bihar, the mindset is there, the facility is not. So,
for selective abortion.
Just to play devil's advocate here, you know what I feel about selective abortion? Well, put out to a couple and wants a baby, and if the new baby is going to be born into a world where it's not wanted, and why do you
leaves me a little older?
Yeah, the new baby's not wanted there. Do you think if it's a boy, the whatever he's gonna get is much better than it's gonna be when it's a girl? So I feel, you know, you don't have to. That again boils down to the human rights issue, where it's the parent's choice to choose too. Yeah.
That's the Malpani argument, and it has not very much about it.
Maybe, but you know, you can look, if you're considering the human rights issue, I know. It's just trying to play the devil's advocate here. I'm not saying I'm for it.
Carry it for further, then, you know, it's such a bad climate, Dalits for Dalits, they should be born. I'm just trying to take that argument a little forward. What Hitler did in 1939 and late 1940, was that there was selective sterilization of Jews. So, you are in public health, so you know the eugenics movements. And eugenics sometimes was thought to be a great practice, but now it is discredited as a... Are you familiar with eugenics?
Even in this country, people with certain characteristics were...
Sterilized
or not to have
children,
like
if you are. So, it's basically institutionalizing a form of. I don't like the other, so kill the other. You kill before, you don't let them be born. And basically, you know, as you say, parents would not like, who, does the parent not love the daughter?
It's not that. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. We shouldn't be like, you know, focused on one issue just because we're passionate about that. It's good to consider the other aspect too.
I guess what she's saying is in a sense that, you know, I guess what, okay, my take on this would be that it's coming from the fact that the fact that the woman child is going to be so unwanted in society, right? So maybe focusing on the parents, if that was indeed the focus, which I don't think it is for you, but if that were the focus, like I'll give you a sort of a conservative argument, right? The right-wing argument here, which is that, oh, the solution to this is be completely legislate against abortion. So no abortion, no selective abortion, right? Which I think is the wrong way of approaching, right? Because that's not the root of the problem. If it is not abortion, it's going to be mistreatment after birth. It's going to be something else. You're just sort of postponing the problem. So the problem is a combination of the parents' attitude and...
Absolutely.
That's, so I guess that's what she means by,
okay,
you know, looking at it. Not, like, for example, if you're just focusing on selective abortion to the exclusion of everything else, then this would be a problem. But okay. I don't know.
I don't work on sex selective abortion.
Yeah,
okay, so we work on contraception, and we work on contraceptive education. We also know through aggregate statistics and our own work that people want contraception. The time for contraceptive education is not now, it has happened. So it is not that a rights-based approach is an alternative to an education-based approach. For contraception, the time for education is gone. We've done it for 50 years. We've done, I would say, an excellent job in place. Now the time is to educate men to get vasectomized. We're working on that. It's not that we're not working on that.
Let me ask you something. So just sort of see where you're coming at. Do you think it's a good idea for families to limit the number of children they have?
I don't want to make a choice. I don't want to make a decision for any family. It's a family decision.
So when you
I can give you a theoretical, take on that, on economic arguments. I can give you health arguments, but that will be just a theoretical position. The point is, women and men, couples having the knowledge of, the ability to, and the services for taking, doing what they choose to.
I agree, but it goes back to this problem that, what you call the middle class problem. The middle class problem is the idea that it is good to limit the size of your family at one level, and that contraception as a mechanism for doing that is a reasonable instrument, if you will. But in a very philosophical sense, at least, and even in a moral sense, there is no justification for thinking that other people ought to limit the size of their families.
There's a difference between...
I'm not saying ought at all. I'm not saying ought ever. I have not said ought even once.
There's a difference between individuals or parents deciding to limit their own families versus they saying that others should limit their families. So when they decide to limit their own family, they should have the facility and the proper way to do it, and not, if they decide to do it, the man not even likely deciding that the woman who should get sterilized or not. And the education on that for me is related
isn't that,
to
that
issue.
Isn't that
it's actually a gender inequality issue.
No, I don't dispute that at all. But this promotion of access to contraception, does that perpetuate the idea that it is good to limit the size of your family? And is that a problem?
Where would you like me to answer from
is
my question?
There are a lot of arguments for that. I mean, if those arguments are pressed, then it's not a bad thing. It's just that you have to make an economic and health choice.
Like, who's going to bear the brunt of carrying those like 20 children? That's what
I'm just
globally. Including my grandparents.
Sure, it's good to limit it.
I come from an older generation. For instance, my mother gave birth to 13 children. 7 of them survived, but she did give birth to 13 children. Literally, eventually, she stopped producing only because she
told to do this.
That was the usual thing in the old days. My older sister, who was 17 years older to me, she gave birth to a child every year until she finally just was not able to. So to me, then what he is talking about has a far more fundamental problem, that what used to happen to these women were they were just treated as, you know, oh, so she's pregnant again, she's pregnant again, she's pregnant again. That was every year. That has to be fought, it seems to be, because of her health reason. And then, of course, you know, this, it's a very enervating experience for a woman. Not enough food, not enough this, not enough that. On top of that, she has to feed a child.
So, you see,